thank you for that introduction, Brian. Very kind of you. And it is an honor to be here. Thank you for everybody that's made this possible. Again, to the Gather to Grow group, True Vine Christian Church, and to the Philosophy Honor Society. Thank you for making this possible. You know, anytime you invite somebody from Nebraska to come to Miami, well, we're going to say yes. So feel free to continue inviting me. My wife and I love being here. This is actually the third time I've been here in about a year. And so every opportunity I've become here, I absolutely love this place. And you guys are blessed to be here in God's country. But, you know, tonight I've been asked to speak about a very specific topic, and it's a topic that I'm not used to giving in lectures like this. I'm normally asked to come present arguments for the existence of God, or maybe arguments for the existence of the human soul. That's one thing I really love to talk about. That's what I devoted my master's thesis to. I believe we can prove the soul exists logically. And many times I'm asked, well, can you convince us that maybe atheism or that atheistic naturalism in particular is false? And I love talking about these things, and that's what I spend most of my time doing. But tonight, the specific question to be addressed is this. If one is sympathetic to arguments for theism, or if one has come to the conclusion that God exists, well, why should we jump to Christianity? If one is open to these theistic arguments, why should we then think Christian theism in particular is true? Well, tonight, I want to bake a cake, so to speak. A metaphysical cake, if that's all right. Let's bake a metaphysical cake together. And the ingredients of this cake, you got to have ingredients for a cake. And so the ingredients of a metaphysical cake tonight are going to be logic, science, the historical method, and some other things. I got some frosting I'm going to put on this cake at the end, too. But, you know, I've seen some estimates that there are over 4,000 religions, worldviews, that make faith systems available to choose from today. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'm taking a multiple choice test, and after every question I've got 4,000 answers to choose from, and I don't know which one is right, and only one of them is right, man, I don't want to take that test. What about you? The odds aren't very good. So the question is raised, can we narrow this down and get a smaller pool of possibly correct answers to choose from? Well, yes, I believe we can. Now, to begin this journey, or rather this process of baking this metaphysical cake, I propose starting with arguments from cosmology. Now, I know that some of you are very familiar with this. But hang with me for a little bit. One of my favorite arguments for the existence of God is known as the Kalam cosmological argument. And those of you that have followed Dr. Craig will know this argument. But let's go through it quickly. The Kalam consists of two premises that lead to a logically deductive conclusion. And this syllogism goes as follows. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore, the universe has a cause. Let's begin with the first premise. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. Begins is the key word. We see examples of this every day in our lives. For example, through the decay of uranium, lead is caused to come into existence. The car factory causes the car to come into existence. And your parents caused you to come into existence. We don't like thinking about that, but it's true. This premise seems intuitively obvious, and is validated every day by an empirical experience. Moreover, a primary metaphysical principle states, out of nothing, nothing comes. Consider the fact that if something could come from absolutely no thing or nothing, then anything and everything could come from nothing at any time. We should be surprised that things don't just come into existence out of nothing all the time. Pizza, music, Lamborghinis. I mean, that'd be nice. They should just pop into existence out of nothing every day. So if something can actually come from literally no thing or nothing, then why can't anything and everything come into existence from nothing? Why is it just universes, is my point. What is it about nothingness that's so prejudiced against everything else except for universes? Obviously, premise one of this argument seems to be self-evident, and at the very least, it's reasonable to conclude that it's at least more plausibly true than not, especially after considering the constant barrage of daily empirical data. Now, that's the first ingredient to our cake tonight. Now, since we've established the rationality of the first premise, let's examine the second. The universe began to exist. One common argument against premise two is that the universe did not begin to exist, but rather has always been here. Well, is this logically possible? Is it scientifically accurate? Those are big questions to ask. Well, this leads us to the next ingredient of our cake, the philosophy of infinity. Now, one philosophical argument promoting the second premise involves the logical impossibility of creating an actual infinite of events in physical space and time to exist. For example, you could start counting 1, 2, 3. But you could count forever, but never reach a time when you finish counting to infinity. You could count forever, but whatever number you were counting at that exact moment would be an actual finite number. You can always add one more to the number you're currently saying or counting. You can always add one more. Therefore, you could never reach the end of infinity. You can always add another. So, is there such a thing as the infinite future? Yes, there is. But it will never get here. It will never get here. So, the question is raised, is an infinite past possible? Well, if the universe did not begin to exist, then it had to have always been here from past infinity. But then, the number of events that happen in the universe would also have to be past infinite, because the universe would be infinite. It would then be impossible to answer many questions. For example, consider the Islamic philosopher around 1,000 years ago named Al-Ghazali and his thought experiment regarding two beginningless series of coordinated events. He encourages us to envision our solar system existing for past infinity. Now, the planet's orbital periods would correspond that for every one orbit Saturn would complete, Jupiter would complete 2.5 orbits around the Sun. Here's the rub. If both Saturn and Jupiter have been orbiting the Sun for past infinity, which planet has completed the most orbits? Initially, you might want to answer Jupiter, because it's closer to the Sun, and it orbits 2.5 times faster. But you'd be wrong. If both planets have been orbiting from infinity past, the correct mathematical answer would be that Jupiter and Saturn have completed the exact same number of orbits. This is ludicrous, because Jupiter orbits 2.5 times faster than Saturn. It would seem that if they had both been orbiting the Sun from infinity past, then Saturn should have fallen infinitely behind Jupiter. And this is a ridiculous paradox, demonstrating the absurdity of an actually infinite past. And since this is absurd, it's evident that the universe did begin to exist, and is therefore not actually infinite. Now, as I stated earlier, it's impossible to reach an actual infinite through successive addition, because we can always add one more to the number we're currently counting. But the same is true once you consider the infinitude of the past while counting down backwards through negative numbers. So consider that 0 equals the present moment. Whatever negative number you would stop on, if you're counting zero, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, negative 1 billion, negative 2 billion, right? Whatever number, even no matter how big it gets, is going to be an actually finite number. You can always add one more. You can always add an infinite more. So whatever negative number you would stop on, and then begin counting back towards zero, which is equal to the present moment, that would be a finite number. It would not be infinite. If it were possible to have a past infinity, then the current moment of right now, zero, would never be here. So if you think the current moment is here right now, then the past cannot be infinite. It had to have a beginning. Comparatively, to help you process this, this idea would be akin to affirming the proposition that one could jump out of an infinitely tall, bottomless pit. Imagine that. Is it possible to jump out of an infinitely tall, bottomless pit? This is logically impossible, even for a superhero with infinite jumping power, as there is no foundation for him to jump from. Since the present moment is real, and we are really here right now, then logically, it had to have been preceded by a finite past. Therefore, there must have been a first event, and the universe came into existence. That is to say, the universe began to exist. So, we can prove this logically. That's a huge ingredient to the cake, to this metaphysical cake we're baking. But perhaps your philosophy is that you don't like philosophy. Have you heard that before? Okay, then, we have other ingredients to add. Scientific validation. Let's look at scientific data that the universe is not infinitely old, our next ingredient. Let's take the second law of thermodynamics, for instance. It states that all of the useful energy that already exists in the universe is being used up and is being transformed into non-usable energy. This refers to a process called entropy. Now, if the universe were infinitely old, then it would have already used up all of its usable energy an infinite amount of time ago. Therefore, we would have reached a temperature of absolute zero and the heat death of the universe an infinite amount of time ago. There would be no heat, there would be no light, there would be no life. Not just in our galaxy, but anywhere in the universe. There's no escape. But there is heat, especially here in Miami. There is light. There is life, right? So since there are pockets of useful energy left in the universe, then it follows that the universe had a starting point. Moreover, scientists can show us through the study of Big Bang cosmology that we live in an expanding universe. Imagine watching a video of the expansion of the universe. Now push pause. Now hit the rewind button and watch the universe shrink, so to speak, back to that initial point of singularity and into nothingness. Eventually, you will come to the beginning of what was expanding. It must have had a starting point. But let me give you the most significant data, scientific data, in my opinion. If entropy and the second law of thermodynamics of Big Bang cosmology was not enough, consider the work of three leading physicists in the world today, Arvind Bohr, Alan Guth, and Alexander Vilenkin. They constructed a theorem known as the BGV theorem of 2003, which reaches the same conclusion, that all nature, even stronger, I think, than Big Bang cosmology, all nature itself had an absolute starting point, an absolute beginning. And no matter what model one holds, even if somebody doesn't like Big Bang cosmology, none of the models available today where the universe is expanding on average like ours is, can be extrapolated into past infinity. Now, the interesting thing here is, I haven't talked at all about God so far, but you probably know, those of you that are familiar with the cosmological arguments, know that we're going into that direction. But consider this about these physicists, Bohr, Guth, and Vilenkin. They're agnostic on the existence of God. In fact, I know at least one of them hopes God doesn't exist. He doesn't want God to exist. So, since they are agnostic on the existence of God. Well, they have no theological access to Grime. So I think we should listen to their conclusions. Dr. Guth, the G in the BGB theorem. He concluded that there was a mother of all beginnings and stated, quote, even within the context of inflation with many bubbles forming, he's talking about the multiverse here, he says there would still be somewhere an ultimate beginning. Dr. Vilenkin, the V in the BGB theorem, makes the point stronger. And I quote, it is said that an argument is what convinces reasonable men, and a proof is what it takes to convince even an unreasonable man. With the proof now in place, cosmologists can no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. There is no escape. They have to face the problem of a cosmic beginning. Well, it follows that if nature had an absolute beginning, if all nature had an absolute beginning, then it's incoherent to state that nature existed before nature existed. That's logically incoherent. And if we care about being intelligent and rational, we've got to avoid logical fallacies and incoherence like the plague. If nature cannot exist before nature exists, therefore the cause of all nature must be something other than nature. You see? It's got to be something else. Now, whatever is called something, or things that are other than nature, well, that's what philosophers call supernatural. Sometimes we have this, we don't like that word because we think of ghosts or, you know, things you see on TV, but it simply means other than nature, supernatural. So, we have scientific evidence that all scientifically testable and discoverable things began to exist. Let that sink in a little bit. We have scientific evidence that everything that can be tested scientifically or discovered scientifically began to exist. Therefore, it logically follows that the cause of all scientifically testable things is necessarily not scientifically testable. You see, a scientist, do we have any scientists in the room today? I love scientists. Thank you for being here. I love you guys. Don't take this the wrong way. Okay. A scientist is simply in the wrong field to continue engaging in this discussion at this point, at least with any expertise. Sure, they can take a layman's interest in these topics, but the letters behind their names give them no authority to speak on things other than nature. Your job is to speak on nature, right? So once we have evidence that scientifically testable things or discoverable things comes to an end, now we have to appeal to logic, reality, or anything other than nature. A scientist is simply in the wrong field to continue having this discussion with authority. Right? Anybody can have this discussion. Right? Anybody can take layman's interest in this. But they're simply in the wrong field. You might as well ask a plumber what they think, because a scientist simply, their job is to study nature. Now, what I'm doing tonight, however, is a little different. I'm appealing to scientific data to prove the universe and all of nature and all scientifically testable things began to exist. Now again, as I showed you, we can demonstrate that logically, apart from science. But all the scientific data, as Alexander Vilenkin said, all of the evidence demonstrates the universe had a beginning, that all nature had a beginning. So now, since we can't do science anymore, we've got to continue thinking according to the rules of reason and the laws of logic. And that should be fine for scientists because science is based on and assumes logic. You can't even engage in the scientific method without first assuming the laws of logic are true. So this leads us to the next ingredient of our metaphysical cake. Leads us to the next ingredient. Let's examine the logical conclusions. Now, if these two premises that we've examined are true, it leads us to a startling but logical conclusion that, therefore, the universe has a cause. Now, the definition of the word universe, in this sense, is anything and everything that is in time and space, including time and space, anything physical and material, anything that can be tested scientifically, it's all nature. And given this definition, then the cause cannot be anything that fits within the definition of universe. Otherwise, the universe would have had to exist before it existed. And that is logically incoherent. You can't say the universe existed before the universe. You cannot say that nature existed before nature. Incoherent. So, what could have caused the universe to exist if nothingness, at least not anything physical or natural, existed before the universe began to exist? Nothingness is causally impotent, as there would be no substances possessing any causal properties. You see, properties do not exist without substances. So what kind of substance could we have or could have caused the universe to bang into existence? This leads to some very important questions. What could exist apart from space-time and matter and still have a causal relation with the material universe? You see, if something can exist in a space-timeless state of affairs, what attributes or properties must this cause possess? This leads us to more ingredients of our metaphysical cake. The rational inferences that are based on the deductive conclusions. If the cause of the universe transcends space-time, all space and all time, then it must have been timeless. Again, we cannot say that time existed before time existed. This means that whatever the cause of the time and space universe was, would have had no beginning. Whatever the cause of time was, whatever started that stopwatch to start ticking, whatever the cause of time was, would have had no beginning, because beginnings require time to already be in existence. Therefore, the cause of time was eternal. Eternal has two definitions. You can exist eternally through all of time, or you can exist eternally apart from time, eternal with no beginning. So in this sense, the cause of time must be eternal without beginning, because a beginning necessitates time to already be in existence. Now, if the cause existed apart from time and had no beginning, we can infer logically that this cause has no cause of its own, as it logically never began to exist. Beginnings require time. And therefore it seems to exist necessarily. It could not fail to come into existence because it never began to exist. It must exist. Moreover, as the Big Bang was the beginning of space-time, then it follows that the cause of the universe also had to have been spaceless. The cause of space has to be spaceless. This means that the cause of the universe would have no size or shape. It was utterly immaterial. Now, if this is hard for you to comprehend, many mathematicians think abstract objects like numbers and sets actually exist. But these are things that you can't touch. You can't dig up the number 7 or find the number 3 floating out in the cosmos. And these are utterly immaterial things. So many mathematicians think that abstract objects are immaterial substances. These are things that would be other than nature. Now, if those mathematicians are right, then naturalism is false. But accordingly, you see, the Kalam takes naturalism off the table as a possible model of reality, because this argument has provided evidence that a supernatural cause of the universe exists. Supernatural. If there's anything that is supernatural that exists, then naturalism is false. What other inferences can we discover regarding the cause of the universe? What can we conclude regarding the cause of the universe, its attributes and properties? Well, this cause must be enormously powerful. I can't think of anything that requires more power than causing a universe to come into existence from nothing. It's got to be enormously powerful. Moreover, the universe's immaterial cause had to have been timeless, spaceless, and it necessarily had the power to spontaneously bring the world into existence without anything else causing it to do so, because then whatever the cause of the cause was would be the cause. But since this cause exists outside of anything physical, material, or temporal, and that's the huge one, time, none of these things could logically cause or force this cause to do anything. Therefore, this cause has its own volition. That is to say, free will. The cause of the universe possesses free will. Why is this? Well, let's consider the words of the renowned physicist, Foitini Markopoulou. And she said, apart from time, things do not happen. Think about that. Apart from time, things do not happen. That is, however, unless something that exists in a timeless and static state can freely choose to act. If something exists in a timeless and static state that has the has volition or free will, can make a choice to act, then this would make sense. Apart from anything abstract, abstract objects, by definition, are causally impotent. They don't cause things. But apart from anything abstract, only an unembodied mind, or something like a human soul, if the soul exists or not is another question, but only abstract objects or unembodied minds are the kinds of things that, if they did exist, could exist apart from time and space. But abstract objects, by definition, don't cause things. So they can't cause the universe. But minds. Well, if minds exist, they do cause things. My mind is telling my right arm to go up. See? Pretty simple. If minds exist, they can cause things. Now, I want to hammer this home. Persons are the only types of things that could possibly possess immaterial minds with free will. Therefore, we can decipher that the cause of the universe is a person. Not to be confused with a human, but a person. I mean, Chewbacca and Yoda, they're persons, in my opinion, if they existed a long time ago, galaxy far, far away. Maybe. But they're not humans, right? But they're still persons. But we can decipher that the cause of the universe was personal. Isn't this what we call a personal agent? A thinking thing who can make free choices and act. If that's not a person, tell me what it is. We can decipher that the cause of the universe, the cause of all time and space, is a person. A personal agent. Now, if it's personal, then whatever it is, this person, can have a personal relationship with other personal beings. Are you a person? Therefore, it's possible for you to have a personal relationship with other persons. And therefore, it's at least possible that you can have a personal relationship with the cause and creator of the universe. Have I touched any religious books? No. My ingredients so far, logic. I've used some scientific data to support a premise and a philosophical argument. That's all. Done some rational inferences regarding the logical conclusion. That's all. Now I call this cause of the universe God. The one is free to call this cause whatever you'd like. However, a rose by any other name is just as sweet. Now, to be clear, the topic of tonight's lecture is not proving that God exists, right? I was asked to come here under the assumption that God exists, or at least under the assumption that we're at least sympathetic to theistic arguments. So maybe you're saying, well, okay, Tim, thanks for this argument. Thank you for proving God exists, but that's not the topic. To this point, I've only appealed to logic and science. I've not touched any religious book. But be that as it may, the attributes that we have drawn from this conclusion correspond perfectly with what the Bible describes as God's properties. I don't want to assume the Bible is true to argue that God exists. I want to give you reason to think that God exists. And now let's look at certain worldviews that affirm the same thing and describe this cause of the universe in the same way. That's why I started with this argument. The Kalam, you see, provides evidence of the ultimate or mega mind behind the universe, which also makes perfect sense regarding the mini minds, the immaterial minds or the souls that humans possess. And it's amazing that by simply employing science, philosophy, and logic, we reach the conclusion that God exists, and we can come to know the specific properties and attributes that the cause of the universe possesses. Moreover, we can also infer that it's at least possible for us to have a personal relationship with the cause of the universe. Now again, this is exactly what the Bible teaches. The Bible doesn't just tell you that it's possible to have a personal relationship with the cause and creator of the universe, but it tells you how, through Jesus Christ. And this is also, if you consider what the Bible says, the Bible is pro-science, in my opinion, my educated opinion. All right. For example, Psalm 19:1. Day after day, your creation pours forth speech. Night after night, it delivers knowledge. What is it saying? Go study nature. Go study nature. Be a scientist. Gain knowledge. Gain knowledge. So, my point is that biblical Christianity is at least left on the table as a possible explanation of reality. So what's been taken off the table at this point? I mentioned we had over 4,000 worldviews to choose from. What's been taken off the table? Well, almost all of that, all of those 4,000, almost all of them, in one fell swoop with the Kalam cosmological argument. For example, atheistic naturalism fails. It's been demonstrated that supernatural things exist through this argument. Therefore, naturalism can't be true. And it'd be a very weird form of atheism to say that there's an eternal, uncaused, supernatural, enormously powerful, immaterial mind with free will that's a person that created the universe, but atheism's still true. That'd be the weirdest form of atheism I've ever heard. So these are taken off the table as possible explanations of reality. What else can we take off the table? Mormonism. You can take Mormonism off the table. Why? Mormonism posits an infinite past universe. We've got logical and scientific data demonstrating that that's false. Other possible ideas of God, like Zeus or Thor, these guys have sizes and shapes. They're contingent upon space. Therefore, they cannot create space. They can't be the cause of space, since their existence demands space to exist in the first place. They have bodies. Any worldview or religion that posits that the universe is past eternal, or that the cause of the universe was something inside the universe, is logically incoherent. any worldview that posits that only nature exists is false. You know, even Stephen Hawking and Alexander Vilenkin, that other physicist that I mentioned, they've made claims recently affirming that nature can't be all that exists. Now, they appeal to abstract objects and Platonism, things like this. But remember, abstract objects don't cause things. Now, I've got to be honest. I have not personally reviewed all 4,000 worldviews. I don't have time for that. I've got some friends, some classmates that have devoted their lives to doing nothing but studying as many religions as possible. But I try to study the main ones, and I try to find as many out there that might work here. But so far, I can think of around four that are strong to consider here. And there are some other. Here we've got Christianity. That makes sense of the data that we've looked at so far. Islam makes sense of the data that we've looked at so far. Judaism does the same thing, and so does deism. That God creates and says, see you later. Doesn't interact in the universe anymore. These things all make sense. And to be honest, there are certain theistic forms of Hinduism, a minority view to be sure, but there are certain theistic forms of Hinduism that would say, yeah, this is right. But any view that says that ultimate reality is impersonal is false. So Buddhism can't be true. Taoism can't be true, and most forms of Hinduism would not be true. So let's focus on these four. These are our four best candidates of reality: Christianity, Islam, Judaism, and deism. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'm taking a multiple choice test and I have to pick between those 4,000 or more possibly correct answers, and only one of them is right, and I can say, or rather, I have another option to take a test with only four possibly correct answers, and only one of them is right, I'm going to take that one. And if I, you know, if I'm going to add in the rare forms, the fringe views of Hinduism or whatever, or I think Sikhism might even also affirm this. All right, six. Let's focus on classical monotheism right now. We can consider those other views too later. But if I'm taking a test and I have 4,000 answers to choose from, or four, give me the one with four all day. My odds skyrocket, right? My chances of getting the answer correct are much better if I'm looking at only four, five, or six to choose from. With that said, however, the odds are still against us, right? If there's only one that's correct, so do we just make a wild guess? Or is there other knowledge to appeal to, other fields of knowledge to appeal to help us make the inference to the best explanation? Are we just left with 25% odds as one out of four? Or are there other factors to consider that would help us make a more informed choice? Again, let me remind you, to this point, the ingredients of our metaphysical cake have been logic and science. I'm not using the Bible to say, the Bible says it, therefore it's true. I'm not going to do that to you. That's not logical. That's question begging. But let's add a field of knowledge to the list to help us make the inference to the best explanation. The next ingredient of our metaphysical cake is the historical method. Now, I'll tell you this. Even if a skeptic starts with the assumption that the Bible is not reliable, they would at least agree with one passage of Scripture. Right? Even the most hardened atheist that I've ever met will at least agree with one passage of Scripture. In fact, they might go as far as to say, well, this one passage of the Bible maybe is inerrant even, maybe infallible. They will at least agree with this, and that is that when Paul says this in 1 Corinthians, if Christ has not been raised, then the Christian faith is meaningless. Basically, what Paul's stating is that if Jesus did not rise from the dead, then Christians, you're a bunch of idiots. You're wasting your time on Sunday mornings and throughout the week, going to church events or whatever. You're wasting your time. You ought to be pitied, is what he says. If Christ has not been raised, we are wasting our time. And Paul is right. If the resurrection of Jesus was not a real historical event, then Christianity is false, and it does not correspond to reality. Now, the interesting thing to consider here is, of the four options that we've considered, Christianity, Islam, Judaism, and deism, three of them reject the resurrection, that it was a historical event. One of them affirms it. So if there is historical evidence of the resurrection, then we have good reason to think that Islam is false. If there is historical evidence of the resurrection, then we have good reason to think that Judaism is false. And if we have historical evidence of the resurrection, then we have good reason to think that deism is false, because deism says God creates and leaves. But this is evidence, arguably, that God creates and enters in and interacts. But if we have historical evidence of the resurrection, then we have good reason to think that Christian deism is probably true. God raised Jesus from the dead. If that statement is true, if God raised Jesus from the dead, then, as C.S. Lewis said, mere Christianity is true. Sure, there's many people that would affirm that statement, and we can argue about subpoints underneath that umbrella, but if God raised Jesus from the dead, if that one single statement is true, then Christianity is true. Mere Christians. And that's what I'm going to argue for tonight. Now, can we gain knowledge of the past? Are there solid reasons and historical evidences justifying the Christian faith without simply assuming that the Bible is the Word of God? Historians have established some guidelines when it comes to reaching conclusions about anything in ancient history. And these are called the rules of historical research. To establish something of the ancient past as historical, we need converging lines of evidence, such as eyewitness data, closeness to the facts, and criteria. And using these guidelines, historians are quite confident in making claims regarding ancient figures like Julius Caesar and Alexander the Great. How can scholars claim to know facts about these ancient dead dudes? But when it comes to establishing historical data, it does not matter if something happened thousands of years ago. What matters is, do we have access to the events that happened all those thousands of years ago? Now, this access is granted through converging lines of evidence, such as written and inferential data. And through this evidence, although a historian cannot know events of history with 100% certainty, they can come to know historical facts with high degrees of historical certainty. And that's what we're arguing for tonight. They can come to know historical facts with these high degrees of historical certainty and the inference to the best explanation. This is very similar to what evolutionary biologists do today. Now, it follows that historians are able to make expert claims about what probably happened when it comes to figures of antiquity, like Alexander the Great, Julius Caesar, and incidentally, biblical figures as well. What's amazing is that the sources for Jesus are far superior to that for Alexander the Great and Julius Caesar. Let's think about the New Testament correctly right now. Think about all the individual letters and biographies that are then collected under the cover of the New Testament. These 27 individual documents were written over many years by multiple authors. Let's we've got to think correctly. It's not one book written by one author all at one time. In fact, even trained skeptics and atheist historians will go to the New Testament and use it for their purposes. Tonight, we're just going to treat it like they do. I'm not going to assume anything supernatural or inspired or inherent or infallible or magical or anything like that. I'm just going to treat the Bible, or namely the New Testament, in the same way that an atheistic historian would treat it. Bart Ehrman. How many of you have heard of Bart Ehrman before? Many of you. Bart Ehrman is probably the loudest and most influential historian arguing against Christianity today. This is what Bart Ehrman has said regarding the Gospels in the New Testament. And I quote, "The oldest and best sources we have for knowing about the life of Jesus are the four Gospels of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. This is not simply the view of Christian historians who have a high opinion of the New Testament and its historical worth. It is the view of all serious historians of antiquity, of every kind, from committed evangelical Christians to hardcore atheists," end quote. So, the New Testament is a collection of historical biographies and letters, and it's recognized as such. But many skeptics arbitrarily choose to ignore parts of these letters and biographies that have anything to do with the supernatural, simply because they presuppose naturalism. Remember, that's begging the question. They're presupposing naturalism to say that, to then conclude that the supernatural things of the New Testament can't be true. But these naturalists are guilty of what we're being careful not to do today. We are not assuming the Bible is God's word to argue that it is, but these atheistic naturalists are assuming nature is all there is to exclaim there is no God. That is the epitome of begging the question. That is a logical fallacy, and any argument based on a logical fallacy is no argument at all. The 27 individual writings, which were gathered over time and eventually comprised under one folder that we simply call the New Testament, covers plenty of data to gain access to the ancient Near East a couple thousand years ago. Oh, but wait, there's more. We also have several non-Christian sources referring to Jesus over the course of the first century. There's also archaeological sources, plus other Christian sources not included in the New Testament. After accumulating all of this data together, we have an abundance of historical evidence and information regarding the man of history, Jesus of Nazareth. But those not trained in the historical method still may complain. How can anyone gain knowledge about anything that happened 2,000 years ago? Well, these folks fail to understand that the length of time between the moment of the event and today is not a primary concern, but rather the gap of time between the historical event and the evidence we have about that event is what is vital. As my professor William Lane Craig said, if the length of time between the event and the evidence for the event is short, then it does not matter how long the evidence and the event itself have receded into the past. Good evidence does not become bad evidence just because of the passage of time, end quote. Now, in the case of Jesus of Nazareth, that time gap is extremely short or narrow. Let's talk about historical data, right? A major ingredient of our metaphysical cake. And let's examine a passage of the letter the Apostle Paul wrote to the Corinthians. It has huge implications. Now remember, I am only treating this as ancient literature, just an old letter. Nothing more. No assumptions here of anything supernatural going on. It's just an old letter. Let's look at it. Consider this piece of significant evidence in the pre-biblical oral tradition that was handed down to the Apostle Paul, which he then records around 55 AD in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 5. This creed states, that Jesus was crucified to pay for our sins, that he died and was buried, that he rose from the dead on the third day, and that he was seen by eyewitnesses. Did you catch all those that's? Well, it's because of that that historians have noted that it's obvious from the wording used in this creed that it is not originally from the author of 1 Corinthians. And this is even accepted by the vast majority of skeptical, atheistic, and non-Christian scholars. That Paul must have received this creed by someone else in Jerusalem, most likely Peter and James, anywhere from 2 to 8 years after the crucifixion. 2 to 8 years. Talk about short or narrow. Paul makes it clear. I gave you what I was given. Now, let's think about this logically. Since the saying already existed when it was first given to Paul, we can logically conclude that this creed was established even earlier. It therefore follows that the beliefs that led to this creed being established, that these beliefs would in fact predate the oral tradition itself. What caused these beliefs? Those would have had to have been even prior to that. Many historians believe that this brings us right back to the year of the cross in 30 AD. Short or narrow time gap. That's what's important here. The historian, James D.G. Dunn, reaches the conclusion that the latest this creed could have been developed is a mere 6 months after the crucifixion. That's extremely early evidence, even by today's standards. The German historian, and atheist, by the way, Gerd Ludemann, reluctantly admits that this creed can be traced back. He's not willing to go 6 months like Dunn is. He's like, oh, that's we can't go 6 months. I'll give you a year. I'll give you 12 months. We can trace this back from 1 to 3 years after the crucifixion. Talk about a short or narrow time gap. We have access to evidence about an event in history. Early documentation also exists that many people, hundreds and hundreds of people, saw the risen Jesus and gave testimony of this within months of the crucifixion. That doesn't prove it's true, but we have evidence that people were reporting that. This provides warrant to affirm the claims stated in this creed are, at the very least, plausibly or probably true. Now, however, if one is still committed to their skepticism, consider the illogicality of a creed being invented and accepted in the very same town that Jesus was reported to have lived, done ministry in, and was publicly executed in, if this Jesus story is just a myth. Consider that. Amy Orr Ewing offers a great thought experiment here. Suppose you want to start your own religion. Maybe because there's lots of money in it, right? So you want to create your own religion, and you develop this story about this amazing man named Hobart. And then you're like, all right, where can we go to start this religion so I can make my big bucks? People in Miami are just too smart. They're not going to believe this. Where can we go? Los Angeles. Okay, so you develop this story about Hobart, and people in Miami are too smart, so you go to L.A. because you know some people in L.A. believe some crazy stuff. Right? He was doing miracles, he was healing people. People were coming to him that doctors couldn't figure out whether he was healing them. Right here in the streets of L.A. on Venice Beach, just a couple years ago. And Hobart, his teachings were so great. I mean, people would flock to listen to Hobart speak. Because his teachings on morality and how we ought to live, I mean, they were just so awesome. Everybody was running to listen to Hobart here just a couple years ago here in Los Angeles, remember? Don't you remember? But Hobart, man, everybody was going nuts about him just a couple of years ago. That eventually, the city officials had to get involved because, you know, things were just getting out of control. And so, you know, things just spiraled even worse and worse. Nice picture, by the way. She drew a picture of me. I just got to say. That's good notes, right? Eventually, the mayor of Los Angeles had to get involved because things just got out of control. And man, the mayor finally said, "Hey, we got to kill this guy on Venice Beach in front of everybody." This happened a couple years ago, don't you remember? Oh, but wait, amazing though. Hobart was so amazing that just 2 or 3 days later, man, he rose from the dead and made appearances to everyone around Venice Beach and just all of Los Angeles. Don't you remember? Just a couple years ago. How many followers do you think you'd get? You wouldn't get any here in Miami. But I think even in LA, I mean, besides Tom Cruise, you'd be lucky to get one. Sorry, I love Tom Cruise. Great actor. Great actor. One of my favorite actors. But he does believe some crazy stuff, right? You want to get thousands of people who would be willing to die for this story. Everyone in LA would have no recollection of such a man or these events, and this movement would never gain enough followers to gain any momentum. This Hobart story would fail. You would not make your big bucks. Such a scheme is obviously ridiculous. It's doomed to fail. However, this is exactly what these Jesus methers claim today. These committed atheists assume this Hobart scenario occurred successfully in first century Jerusalem, as a city with significantly fewer people than Los Angeles. You see, this is not the inference to the best explanation. That's what we're after. This is what scholars care about. What is the inference to the best explanation after considering all of the data? Historians come to conclusions regarding Jesus through multiple testimonies of people who were either companions of Jesus or had firsthand knowledge of Christ. And this is fantastic and extremely early evidence that historians would consider a goldmine regarding any other event of ancient history. So let's be consistent and see that it is a goldmine regarding the person, Jesus of Nazareth. Historians seek independent sources, such as eyewitness accounts, both positive and embarrassing. And let me tell you, these sources are plentiful when it comes to the life of Jesus and his resurrection. One of my professors and a good friend, Michael Lacona, told me that we have as much evidence of the resurrection. He's a historian, by the way. We have as much evidence of the resurrection, if not more, than we have of Julius Caesar's crossing the Rubicon in 49 BC. Nobody doubts that. Even the harshest skeptical and atheistic historians admit several things as historical fact about Jesus. I already mentioned Bart Ehrman and Gert Ludemann. But even the people that comprise this thing known as the Jesus Seminar. Has anybody heard of the Jesus Seminar? You might think, oh, the Jesus Seminar, it must be a pro-Jesus thing. No. It's not, you know, right? These are a bunch of scholars that have gotten together, and they're trying to disprove Christianity. But they are scholars and historians. And they will say, there's some things in the Bible that we can't trust at all. But here's the things, here's the list of things that we can know are true, historically speaking, about Jesus. For example, Jesus existed. Jesus died by crucifixion. Jesus' disciples, at the very least, really believed that Jesus rose from the dead and appeared to them. Now, these guys, these scholars, don't think he actually did. But they will admit, well, man, his disciples at least thought that they experienced the risen Jesus. This is coming from the Jesus Seminar, these atheistic, skeptical historians. Right? They'll admit, the church persecutor and Christian hunter, Saul, was radically transformed into the Jesus-preaching Paul. 5, the skeptic James, the half-brother of Jesus, was suddenly changed and transformed into somebody who was willing to die for the gospel. I mean, who would think your own brother is the Messiah? He was transformed and willing to die for it. Historical fact. The tomb of Jesus was found empty by his women followers. And it's important to note women follow. Now, Mike Lacona, who I mentioned earlier, makes his case even stronger by utilizing a super minimal facts approach that does not even reference the Gospels at all. That is to say, that even if the Gospels did not exist, even if they were never written, or even if they were proved to all be forgeries, we could still come to these historical facts, completely apart from the Gospels. One, Paul was an eyewitness, a hostile eyewitness. Two, Paul knew Jesus' disciples. Three, Paul taught what the disciples taught. They were on the same page. Four, they taught appearances to individuals and groups, to friend and foe alike. And five, the apostles and Paul taught and believed that Jesus was physically raised from the dead. Now, 1 through 4 are accepted facts regarding Jesus, even by skeptical historians. They will at least grant these. And so 1 through 4 are accepted as historical facts. And the fifth, although not accepted by all skeptics, to this day remains unrefuted. So, when it comes to the historical method, we need to ask the following question. What hypothesis best accounts for all of these facts together at the same time? This is what historians do. The resurrection hypothesis, God raised Jesus from the dead, if that's true, makes sense of every fact that I've listed so far today. That one can make sense of all of it. To this day, after 2,000 years of trying to come up with other hypotheses to explain all the facts, they fail. No other naturalistic hypothesis offered accounts for all of these facts together. Sure, some of them can explain some of these naturalistic-based hypotheses can explain some of the facts, but not all of them. And an inference to the best explanation is a hypothesis that can explain all the facts at the same time. Now, the best explanation of the facts is the hypothesis which makes sense of all of them together simultaneously, and the resurrection hypothesis is the only one left on the table after considering the criteria historians use, such as explanatory scope, explanatory power, plausibility, ad hoc. If there's an explanation that is just completely contrived and ad hoc, well, that's not as good as an explanation that's not ad hoc. Mike Lacona once told me, and I quote, "The main objection to the resurrection is not a lack of historical evidence. We have that. Rather, it's a matter of worldview, because the resurrection of Jesus requires a supernatural being to exist." End quote. Remember, assuming that God does not exist, to argue that God cannot raise Jesus from the dead is begging the question. That's circular reasoning. That's a logical fallacy. And any argument based on a logical fallacy is no argument at all. You haven't given me any reason to think that's true if you beg the question or reason in a circle. But remember, we are not assuming God exists to conclude that God raised Jesus from the dead. I'm not doing that tonight. I offered evidence for the existence of a personal cause and creator of the universe at the beginning of my talk. I have reason to think God exists. It's not an ad hoc assumption. I'm not begging any questions. I provided reason. And let me tell you, I gave you one argument. We have a cumulative case of powerful arguments, independent arguments, that all reach the same conclusion. I've just given you one tonight. Even though I was asked to come here under the assumption that God exists. But I wanted to start with the Kalam to demonstrate that I am not begging the question. Now, if God can create an entire universe from nothing, raising a man from the dead is child's play for this creator of the universe. Therefore, one has no grounds to reject the historical evidence in regards to the resurrection of Jesus based on their atheistic or naturalistic assumptions. assumptions, presuppositions without evidence. The evidence, however, supports God's existence and the resurrection of Jesus by supernatural means. You know, the famous skeptic Dave Hume. Has anybody heard of Dave? Right? I like Dave, right? Dave Hume made it clear. He was a skeptic. Dead men do not rise from the dead naturally. Well, I agree, Dave. I agree 100%. Therefore, the inference to the best explanation of the historical resurrection is that God, the supernatural creator of all nature, raised Jesus from the dead. Now, if God raised Jesus from the dead, then Islam is false. If God raised Jesus from the dead, Judaism is false. And if God raised Jesus from the dead, deism is false. But if God raised Jesus from the dead, then Christianity is true. Mere Christianity, as C.S. Lewis said. Moreover, if God raised Jesus from the dead, then we seem to have a divine stamp of approval regarding everything that Jesus said, taught, and exemplified. Count this as more ingredients to our metaphysical cake when we're trying to discover ultimate reality. It's important to note that Jesus not only taught out of the Old Testament, he also gave his stamp of approval on the law and the prophets in Matthew 5, verse 18. Moreover, a case can be made that the resurrection validates the teachings of Jesus' handpicked apostles, who either wrote or provided the information found in the books and letters of the New Testament. For example, a strong case can be made that Peter is the source for Mark, which is the earliest written gospel. But given the abundance of multiple and early attestation of the Gospels, now, as historians, we have high degrees of historical certainty when it comes to knowing what Jesus actually taught. Remember the Bart Ehrman quote, the agnostic who leans towards atheism that I offered earlier. He would agree. Therefore, one has good reason to trust that the New Testament that you can hold in your hands today or get on your iPhone, that the New Testament, which is based on thousands and thousands of early copies of the original Greek manuscript, we do not have the original autographs, but we have thousands and thousands of extremely early, short copies in the Greek. We can know what Jesus taught with high degrees of certainty. And so, given the thousands of early copies of the original Greek manuscripts, we can conclude that the New Testament is not only trustworthy, but that it's the authoritative word of the creator of the universe. Now notice, I'm not arguing for inerrancy, am I? I'm not arguing for infallibility. I'm not arguing for anything supernatural or inspired, supernaturally inspired. I'm just arguing that the Bible is trustworthy. The scientists, when you go through science textbooks, you don't claim that they're inerrant or infallible without error. But when you say they're trustworthy, yeah, I do too. I said it. I love science. I'm just making the same case for the Bible. In summary, let's look at an argument based on everything I've said here. One, Jesus' resurrection validates the teachings of Christ and his handpicked apostles. So, if God raised Jesus from the dead, then we seem to have a divine stamp of approval on everything that Jesus did, and that includes who he taught, or who he picked, to continue teaching. Two, the New Testament was written by Jesus' handpicked apostles, or those who knew them, like Mark. Three, the text of the Bible is pure enough. Given textual criticism, scholars have concluded that they can craft the New Testament with over 97% accuracy to correspond to the original autographs. Four, in the New Testament, by the way, over 97% accuracy is awesome, but that also means that the Bibles that we hold in our hands today are not the original, right? So when we argue for, if anybody does argue for inerrancy or infallibility or anything like that, they're talking about the originals, not what we hold today. So there might be a mistake or two, or an error or two in what we hold today. But it's over 97% accurate. So let that sink in. Four, in the New Testament, Jesus gave his stamp of approval on the Old Testament. He taught out of it. Five, given 1-3, we have good reason to regard the New Testament as trustworthy and authoritative. And given 4, we have good reason for regarding the Old Testament as trustworthy and authoritative. What can we conclude? Go read your Bible. I've baked a cake. I've used nothing but logic, supported it by scientific data. I've used the historical method, and I've baked a cake. Now, I don't know about you, but when I bake a cake, I like to put some frosting on. So I want to put some frosting, some metaphysical frosting on this metaphysical cake. Now, I was planning tonight. I don't have enough time to do it right now. But originally, I was planning to go into the ontological argument. Who's familiar with the ontological argument for the existence of God? Not very many, surprisingly. Now, Anselm originally developed this around 1,000 years ago. I think you could poke some holes in it. But Alvin Plantinga and a few others have reformulated it recently and made it very strong. I was initially not persuaded by it. Even though I was a Christian, I still wasn't persuaded by it. I've come to see I don't have a reason to reject it anymore. But I'm not going to give this argument right now. We can talk about it later if you'd like. Because anyway, we are assuming that God exists tonight for our purposes. So let's talk about God. What is the definition of God? Does anybody here speak Latin?
Yes.
Okay. That is because I'm probably going to butcher this. But the definition of God in Latin is this. Aliquid quo nihil meus cogitare posit. Translation, God is something which nothing greater can be conceived. Or rather, in more idiomatic English, God is the greatest conceivable being. Or like I like to say, God is the maximally great being. A maximally great being would be a being that cannot be improved upon. So if, and that's what we mean by God, a maximally great being. So if you're thinking about God, a maximally great being, in a manner in which you think he could be improved upon, then you are not thinking of a maximally great being, God, in the first place. This is what we call perfect being theology, and I love doing perfect being theology. Now here's my point. So far, as I've said several times, our ingredients have been, I've appealed to reason based upon logic, science, and the historical method to bake my metaphysical cake, and to conclude that Christian theism is at least probably true, and what I mean by that is that it is the inference to the best explanation. And I hope that you appreciate the fact that I'm saying probably being on a university campus, right? I'm saying probably, it is the inference to the best explanation. Christianity, you see, is the only worldview that can make sense of all the data, all those ingredients that we've looked at so far. But right now, however, I want to change my tactics, and I want to appeal to your intuition. Now, to be clear, this is not the same kind of proof. It's not logical proof like I've been arguing for with the other arguments. But it is something to pay attention to. Pay attention to your intuition. And consider this as frosting on the cake. And if you don't like frosting, scrape it off. You still have the cake to deal with. But let's consider this. Let's think about the terror attack in France. Happened recently. Oh, thanks, brother. Let's think about these terror attacks that happened in France. And let's let's look at these attacks through the lens of certain worldviews. Let's just start with atheism. There was nothing objectively wrong with these attacks. If God does not exist, then objective moral values and duties or obligations do not exist. Objective duties or obligations or morals. Objectively speaking, who knows what objective means when I say that? I mean something that's true apart from human opinion. Okay? So if God does not exist, then objective morals and values do not exist. And so according to consistent atheism, there's nothing really wrong with those attacks. You might have a personal dislike for it. You might have a personal dislike with what I'm wearing, but does it make it objectively wrong that I'm wearing this? You might have a dislike for pickles. Does it make it objectively wrong if somebody else likes them? According to consistent atheism, there's nothing really wrong with these terror attacks. In fact, on naturalistic atheism, these attacks were unavoidable. If naturalism is true, you see, these terrorists were not responsible for these actions. It was simply physics and chemistry. Physics and chemistry, nothing more. You shouldn't be mad at ISIS. You should just sit back and say, wow, look what physics and chemistry just did. They don't have a choice in the matter if all that exists is nature. So, according to consistent atheism, and especially atheistic naturalism, or naturalistic atheism, I should say, there's nothing objectively wrong with these attacks. What about Islam? Well, these attacks were good, as Muhammad's final commands were to kill the infidels. Now, one might object and say, well, there's also verses in the Quran that are peaceful, pro-peace. Yeah, the Quran's very inconsistent. But according to Islamic theology, whatever Muhammad said last abrogates his earlier statements. And Muhammad's final commands were kill your enemies, kill the infidels. Now, what about consistent Christianity? Now, are there many inconsistent Christians in the world today? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Okay. I'm not talking about Christians, people that say they're Christians and don't act like it. I'm talking about what did Jesus teach? Consistent Christianity. If you look at these attacks through the lens of consistent Christianity, then these attacks were objectively wrong and evil. According to the law of Christ, all humans are commanded to love all humans. According to Jesus, you are to love everyone, from your neighbor to your enemies. Jesus said, love your enemies. Muhammad said, kill them. Now, appealing to your intuition, after thinking about a maximally great being, doing perfect being theology, don't you think Jesus' words correspond to that of a maximally great being? Perfectly good and all-loving, omnibenevolence, which would be an attribute of a maximally great being. Is there a best choice option of all these worldviews? Yes, there is. It is the one that's supported by all the evidence, and it's the one that commands everyone to love everyone. Even your enemies. Can you imagine if everyone listened to Jesus, if everyone followed the teachings of Jesus? Can you imagine if everybody tried to approximate and align their lives with the teachings of Jesus Christ? Can you imagine what this world would be like if everyone actually loved everyone? I mean, sounds like heaven on earth to me. Well, sign me up for that world. I want to live in a world where everybody truly loves everyone. I think about Jesus teaching the parable, the fictional story of the Good Samaritan. But then when he got done, I mean, he's talking about the Good Samaritan, somebody going out of his way to make sure a fellow human in need who didn't even like him flourished. Can you imagine if we all did that? As soon as Jesus got done telling that parable, the fictional story, he looked at the crowd and said, go and do likewise. Can you imagine what this world would be like if we all listened to Jesus? He sounds like a maximum great being to me. It sounds like he is teaching perfect being, how we ought to approximate to a perfect being. And then you consider Galatians 5, 22 and 23, where it said in the fruit of the Spirit, if you're walking with Jesus, then you will produce good fruit like love, joy, peace. Peace would be nice, wouldn't it? Patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Man, who doesn't want to live in a world where everybody is exhibiting that fruit? I gotta tell you, after considering all of the data, I am convinced that the inference to the best explanation is, at the very least, mere Christianity. At least some stripe of Christianity. Sure, Christians argue all the time about little points of doctrine underneath the umbrella of Christianity, but mere Christianity, the teachings of Jesus Christ, that is, it's got to be true. After recording all the data, that is the inference to the best explanation. And therefore, it's reasonable, you hear, reasonable to put your trust, aka your faith, in Jesus Christ. It's a reasonable faith, as Dr. Craig says. It's not a blind leap of faith. It's a little step, a reasonable step, based on logic, supported by science and the historical method. You see, after considering all of the data, all of those ingredients of our cake, that is why I am a Christian theist today. Tonight, I'm not asking you to take any blind leaps of faith. However, I do encourage you to take a reasonable step of faith based on the evidence, based on reason, and put your trust in Jesus Christ. If we all did that, this world would be an amazing place. I think Christian theism is the inference to the best explanation. Dave Hume, let's bring him up one more time. Dave Hume once said, wise men choose probabilities. Dave, I agree. I agree 100%. Wise men do choose probabilities. I could not agree more. Tonight, I have demonstrated that Christian theism is probable. We've baked a metaphysical cake, and our ingredients of this cake were logic and science and the historical method. And through these knowledge disciplines, we have concluded that Christian theism, in particular, is the best explanation of reality. And on top of that, I even appeal to your intuition to add a little bit of frosting to your metaphysical cake. Tonight, I have demonstrated that Christian theism is probably true. Therefore, a wise man or a woman should choose to put your reasonable faith in Jesus Christ. Now, let's have our cake and eat it too.
We're going to give him about 1 minute to drink water, catch his breath. Man, definitely appreciate Tim, and definitely appreciate this night and his time and his mind. He's got an incredible mind. I know that I was sitting here probably in a way going, all right, let me catch up, let me write down, let me postulate about these things. And we want to give you a chance now to be able to do some of that. We want to be able to have some response. We want to have some questions. And so for the next 45 minutes, we're going to kind of devote to some Q&A. And we could probably take one question and talk for hours on it. And so what we do want to do is we do want to challenge you to, as we do the question and answer, be as concise and clear as you can possibly be. But knowing Tim, man, he's just going to love engaging and dialoguing with as many of you as we can. With that being said, though, those cards on your table, I challenge you, you don't need that card to stand up. We don't need you to read it. But We do want you, though, if we don't get to your questions, we as a team that have put on this event, have sponsored this, we want to work with Tim to follow up with you in the next week. So like myself, I'm one of the pastors at True Vine Christian Church, one of the sponsors. And then we have Gathered to Grow, which is one of the sponsors in his ministry. He's one of the sponsors in the Philosophy Honor Society as well. And so we do want to follow up with him on these questions. We don't want to just leave it hanging. Sure. But we also know that we probably won't get time to have all of you ask and get your answer as well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to be the runner. I'm going to be sent out there. I'm going to give you the microphone primarily just for some recording purposes and just so we all can hear. And then we'll just go with that. And then in about 45 minutes, I'll be the timekeeper. We'll just kind of end it. And I don't know for sure if we're having pizza or not. I've sent a crew, and I told them if it's raining so hard, just come back. We can make do without. But if it shows up, man, we want to keep the dialogue going even after 45 minutes. Okay. All right. So, pause. Think. I'm going to move over here. He's going to come back up. And if you have a question, raise your hand, and I will try to be that guy. Let's see. Let's go front row first, and I'll make my way back to you. And it's up to you. He probably could give you. You'll ask a question. He'll respond, and then sometimes he'll just fill it out if Tim wants to give you a chance to respond as well.
Who are some of your favorite philosophers?
Definitely the philosophers who I have been most influenced by are the ones that are currently living. And a lot of people think that is a mistake. But, you know, anybody in any field of knowledge stands on the shoulders of the giants that preceded them. And so the reason why I'm probably more influenced by modern philosophers is because they're already taking the data and the work of these old dead dudes that were great. And I mean, I love Anselm, by the way. You know, is he a philosopher or a theologian or whatever, you know, but probably both. But for example, Alan Flanagan has stood on the shoulders of Anselm. Oh, and I love Leibniz. Fantastic thinker, one of the co-founders of calculus. You know, very smart guy. He's the one, he's actually got an argument called the Leibnizian cosmological argument. Another old dead dude. But yeah, I mean, definitely William Lane Craig has been the biggest influence on my life. J.P. Moreland, Alan Plantinga, and man, I could give you a whole lesson. They're probably the top three guys. And I've never met Plantinga. I've studied his work extensively. But Craig and Moreland have been two of my professors. And I, you know, Free Thinking Ministries is an affiliate of Reasonable Faith. And so I don't get to talk to Dr. Craig a lot, but I do get to have some interaction with him. Yeah, thanks for the question.
All right, Tim, right here.
Yes.
Hey, I kind of felt that when you were arguing that it was a personal document, that you were making assumptions.
Where were those at?
Because we don't know anything outside of the universe. And my question is, why couldn't it be a natural cause that outside of this universe, it is infinite, but it just works just like how stars were born here in our universe.
Okay, well,
it just makes universes.
Yeah. So we don't know anything scientifically.
Yeah.
But again, I appeal to logic. So appealing to logic, we can come to know things. For example, even if nothing existed, the law of the excluded middle would still exist. The universe does not exist, true or false. And so I mean, that's just how it is. And so we can come to know some truths apart from space-time. And so that's all I did. And now consider time. I didn't just make a jump. I reasoned in a logical manner. If time doesn't exist, as Foitino Markopoulo made clear, the physicist, then things do not happen. And so that includes universes beginning.
Right? Outside of this universe, could there be time?
Well, no. No, there couldn't. Because you cannot have an infinite amount of space or of time in the negative. I spent a lot of time on that. And that doesn't just mean this universe. That means, let's go to my time proves God argument. And let's demonstrate this. One, things change, right? Now that's debatable. There's some physicists that say, no, things don't change. Okay, we can have that conversation. But if you think things change, premise one is true, or granted, right? And I believe to the physicists that argue that things don't change, I can prove them wrong. And it's a self-defeating claim. We can discuss that. But one, things change. Two, a changing state of affairs cannot be past infinite. Remember, if you think that that's true, that's akin to affirming the proposition that you could jump out of an infinitely tall bottomless pit. So if you think the current moment of right now exists, then you cannot have an infinite changing state of affairs. Okay, things change, a changing state of affairs cannot be past infinite, therefore, a first change resulted from an unchanging state of affairs. Now remember, this is also what the Borg-Guttmann-Langen theorem demonstrated. It's not just this universe. And this is what even leads Alexander Vilenkin, the V of the BGV theorem, to state, gosh, we gotta have these abstract Platonic laws and things like that. Stephen Hawking says, because there is such a thing as gravity. Okay, that's an abstract law. Okay, it's not a thing you can touch. It's not a scientifically or empirically, you can't touch that thing, right? You don't dig it up. So they're affirming, let me get back to the other. So therefore, a first change resulted from an unchanging state of affairs. Things were not changing. Okay, it's logically impossible. I'm speaking logic, not science. It is logically impossible to extrapolate the past into infinity if you think the current moment exists. Four, only volitional agents can cause a change from an unchanging state of affairs. You think that's a jump? Okay.
Why do they need?
Because things do not happen. There's no decay. Let's just assume that, I mean, because we have evidence that even space came into existence, and that would even mean the space that would be required that a quark is contingent upon, okay? Or anything with a size or shape, no matter how small in the subatomic realm. But let's just assume for the sake of argument that a quark existed or some subatomic particle. Okay, but if these... through the decay of uranium, I said earlier, there's no decay apart from time. Decay is something that happens in time. Evolution is change over time. Emergence is what happens in time. If there is a static and changeless state of affairs, as some physicists think is the current state of affairs, but if there is a static and changeless state of affairs, then nothing happens. So, that's why this premise is defendable. Only a volitional agent can cause a change from an unchanging state of affairs. Something that could make a choice. Okay? If it's just, again, time and space both came into existence, but for the sake of argument, if I grant space and something physical, what's going to happen to that if it exists in a static state? And that's why those who are from the B theory of time today and marry it to eternalism, well, you will exist for eternity. You never began to exist, and nothing can happen to you to cause you, your slice of the block, to stop existing, because things do not happen apart from time. So this is just, if nothing happens, what's the only thing that can cause something to happen in a static and changeless state? If it's a mind, right? And again, remember, the only things that philosophers can think of that could possibly exist in, or apart from time and space, is either abstract objects or unembodied minds. There's debate if both of those things exist. But, and I devoted my master's thesis to proving minds exist, but be that as it may, if they exist or not, they're the only kinds of things that, if they did exist, could exist in that state of affairs, in a time-spaceless state of affairs. But if a mind exists, abstract objects don't cause things by definition, but if minds exist, they're the kinds of things that can make choices to act. So if a mind, the same mind that caused the universe, if a mind exists in a static, timeless state, and if that mind has free will, then it can choose to act. And that would be the first act resulting to the state of affairs, the changing state of affairs that we have today. So let me go through the rest. With four, only a volitional agent can cause a change from an unchanging state of affairs. You gotta refute that to say it's a jump. Okay, because I've offered a reason, an explanation to think it's true. That is no jump. Okay, that is not any question begging. I've said if you've got a mind in a static state who can make a choice, then something can happen resulting from a static state. So that there is no question begging, no jumping. I gave you a reason. And to reject it, you have to give me refutation of that. Five, volitional agents are personal. Six, therefore, this personal agent existed in an unchanging state of affairs. Seven, anything existing in an unchanging state of affairs never began to exist and is eternal with no beginning. And eight, therefore, the cause of the first change and ultimately the change of affairs in which we find ourselves today is a personal agent who is eternal with no beginning and was in a changeless state of affairs logically prior to causing the first change. I have an article on my website called Time Proves God. I encourage you to read the whole thing, then contact me, and we can continue to discuss it. Thanks for your great question, and I was hoping that somebody would ask that question, so thank you for asking. Great question.
All right, we have one more, or we have one of probably many, but here's one more question.
Hey, Ben. Thanks for coming out today.
Thanks, brother.
Thanks for your talk. I heard you mention this in your previous answer, but I wanted to talk about like some quantum physics I've heard suggests that subatomic particles can fluctuate into existence without a cause. So if that is true, then what implications does that have on the first premise of your cosmological?
Yeah, guys like Lawrence Krauss have argued that, physicists from Arizona State, I believe. But he has been. I mean, Dr. Craig has debated him, I think, four times now. And he's just really demonstrated why this doesn't work. And guys like George Ellis and Alexander Belenkin himself, these cosmologists that are seem to be the maximally great cosmologists, they've refuted Krauss's work as well. The problem is that Krauss says that these quarks, can come into existence from nothing, and they do all the time. Well, the problem is that he's confusing and equivocating or equating nothingness with a quantum vacuum. And the quantum vacuum, it's based on the laws of nature. It's within the natural universe. This vacuum is filled with roiling, violent energy. Like I said, governed by the laws of nature, and these quarks come into existence from that. So it's the quantum vacuum that causes it. And the quantum vacuum is within the natural universe. The quantum vacuum is filled with energy. That we've got attributes and properties to this thing, and therefore it's not nothing. So remember I said scientists have no authority to speak on some things, and he's making a mistake here. He's not a philosopher. And so he's really making a huge mistake at that point. So quantum vacuum is not nothing, therefore his objection. Good question.
Any other questions? All right, going once. There we go.
I want to know what you said that Wurlingham Craig, he says that it doesn't matter how far back we go with a certain event, but that if the evidence is short after that, that it's good evidence.
Again, that's it, man. What do you think about the teachings of Jesus? And I talked about the Good Samaritan. You know, wouldn't it be awesome if everybody lived like that? And he's like, yeah, can't argue with that. What do you think about when he says, hey, everybody love everybody, from your neighbors to your enemies? Don't you like that? He goes, yeah. He goes, everybody should. Finally, he said, everybody should follow the law of Christ. And I'm like, but yeah, but this would be a great world, wouldn't it? If everybody followed the teachings of Christ, this would be a great place. To me, it seems like those teachings correspond to perfect being theology. And I don't think that Islam, go kill your enemies. To me, maybe I'm missing something. That's why I'm not dying on this hill. But But that's why I said, let's start with perfect being theology and then compare the teachings of the different worldviews and religions. Now, maybe somebody said, well, what about the God of the Old Testament? That's just saying, okay, you don't think the Old Testament's inerrant. That's really what that is. If you're like, yeah, perfect being exists, Jesus' words correspond to it, but look at this Old Testament thing. Okay, at most, all you're saying is, I don't think the Old Testament's inerrant or infallible. I'm not arguing for that today. Anyway, I've kind of gone on some tangents. Maybe that raised other questions.
So we have about we have 12 minutes.
Okay,
until we'll kind of formally call it. We have Julian, who's already asked two questions. Ozzy has a question. And although I would love to hear them, I do want to give other people voices here for a second. Is there anybody else that has a question right now? Mr. Zach. You want to go, Zach? All right. I'll move down to the front, then I'll loop back to Ozzy, okay? Julian, you can talk to him later.
You got to send me a picture of that picture. That was good, yeah. Really good.
Portrait. Yeah, so from my understanding, Jesus wants us to be witnesses, right? And go out and tell everyone who he is, right? And to follow her question, which is awesome. Being that I am just a man who I believe God has allowed to physically and tangibly experience instances of supernatural activity, like an extreme case of, let's say, a demon being liberated from a person, a family member for that matter, miracles or incredible prayers being answered with no explanation, and people still don't believe, even with all the historical evidence, then would you say if people deny Jesus as Lord, being told from a family member or a friend, because I experienced this a lot, would you think it's mostly because it's because of a hardening of their heart for whatever reason, or because there's somewhat of an accountability for their own lives? And then if that's the case, what is the hope for that person?
Great questions. I have come to the conclusion that most of the time, this is based on my interactions, and I talk with atheists and non-believers all the time. It's my full-time job, basically. And I really think the reason why most ignore all of this evidence. I gave you the tip of the iceberg tonight. There is so much evidence for the existence of God. I gave you the reasons why I think Christianity is true on top of that. There's so much to prove of God's existence. That we don't even get to. But if one is an atheist, ignores all the arguments for God, and continues to hold that there's no evidence for atheism. You can't prove it. It's an assumption based on with no evidence. So it's a presupposition, an assumption. It's a presupposition to argue. You're thinking it's true to argue it's true. That's with circular reasoning and begging the question. But so why do they do that? I'm not saying all, but man, my experience is, man, if Christianity is true, then there is objective morality and obligations that I have, and it affects my life. I've got to make some changes. Not just in what I do, but even in how I think. I can think of some horrible things right now. Jesus said, hey, don't even think those things. Paul said, take those thoughts captive to obey Christ. He also, that's a 2 Corinthians 10:5, take your thoughts captive. Colossians 2:8, he basically says you could be taken captive by these thoughts. You entertain these things, they're going to dominate your life. And we like to live how we want to live. We have these desires. And when you feed those desires, it's scientifically demonstrable too, and like self-directed neuroplasticity, look at the work coming out of UCLA right now. The way you freely choose to think actually changes your material mind. So your immaterial thoughts that you're in control of actually changes the grooves in your brain. It's crazy. Your immaterial thoughts. You can't touch your thoughts. I could cut your head open right now. Don't want to. But if we did, I couldn't touch your thoughts, right? I could touch your brain. Your brain is material, your thoughts. You can't dig them up, right? you can't touch them. They're not empirically discoverable. So your thought is not material. But these non-material things, the way you freely choose to think, actually changes your brain structure. Self-directed neuroplasticity, look at the work of Dr. Jeffrey Schwartz. This is out of UCLA. And, you know, when you consider, Paul was teaching the same stuff. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Take your thoughts captive. Don't be taken captive by your thoughts, by shallow philosophy. If you do these things, you'll be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Paul was onto something some 2,000 years before UCLA caught up with him. The reason why I think most people reject it, though, is because, man, if this is true, I've got to change. I had to change. I mean, man, I'll tell you what. I'm talking too much.
Okay. We can talk about it.
Yeah.
Let's have one more question, and then okay. we'll do some conclusions and stuff. I think it's Ozzy.
Based on Dr. Lam, argument, why is polytheism not a bad
Occam's thing? Razor. And, you know what Occam's Razor?
Yeah.
Why posit multiple things when one thing is sufficient? Now that's one reason. Also positing the ontological argument. It's logically impossible to have two maximally great beings. It's just as logically impossible to do that as it is to say there's an irresistible force and an immovable object in the same world. You can have one of those things in one world, but not both of them simultaneously. Other reasons. Apart from time, things aren't happening. So even if you had all these different necessarily existing, which again, ad hoc. You we've got a resurrection argument, too. We can add that to the mix. If God raised Jesus from the dead, then we have a divine stamp of approval on everything that Jesus said, God exemplified, and Jesus spoke of one cause of the universe, one God. So you've got all these different things. But apart from time, things don't happen. And like I said, we're arguing for a first cause. And those causes can't be extrapolated. If things are actually happening one after another, that can't be extrapolated into past infinity. So, as I said in my talk, if we're going to talk about what caused the cause, well, let's talk about that. Are you going to extrapolate that back into past infinity? So, you can't do that, logically speaking. So, if the cause can't cause the cause, but whatever the cause was of the universe exists necessarily. And we can go, the necessary existence.